Hey, how you all going? It's Jai, that Aussie metal guy here with crank.com and with that metalstation.com. And today I'm getting to have a chat with Margarita from Edge of Paradise, who are due to release their fourth studio album, The Unknown. They've already released a couple of singles from it, My Method, Your Madness and Digital Paradise. Margarita, thank you for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure.
No, it's an absolute pleasure coming across your music as well. It's one of those things where I have so much music. I'm always hearing new bands and it kind of blows me away, some of the talent and quality of these bands that I'm chatting to. First off, can you tell me a little bit about the history of Edge of Paradise? I'm pretty keen to hear how it progressed to where you are now.
Yeah, we started, it's actually going to be 10 years in September. Yeah. So we've been around for a while. Dave, who's the guitar player, started the band with me. I moved to Los Angeles about 10 years ago. And when we met, he was working on a project with Robin McCauley, Greg Bissonette, and Tony Franklin. And they all kind of dispersed for touring. So Dave wanted to start a band that, you know, someone could pretty much follow through, you know, take it all the way where it can go. So we had similar passion, we had similar work ethic, we had very different styles of music because I came from like classical piano and theater, and Dave is a heavy metal guy. So it took us a few years to really find how to write together, find our sound. And I think that's what's cool about our music is that we bring so many different not even styles, but different sides of ourselves and put it into, you know, our sound, basically. So, I mean, you know, it took us a while to get going, like finding members. We toured US. We eventually went to Europe to a festival. Then as the band grew, we went to Japan. We did a European tour recently. This is going to be our fourth album. So things have been just going nonstop because we're always, you know, we're always trying to push it forward.
Yeah, I really do like the different elements that Edge of Paradise incorporates. As you mentioned there, you can go from the heavy metal and you've got those real pop elements, but you've got the classic symphonic elements as well to it as well. How did you originally get into singing and vocal work? Were you a pianist first or did it go from, yeah?
Yeah, you know, I never thought I'd be a singer. It's still kind of weird to call myself a singer because I was a pianist most of my life. And like I did theater, so I did a little bit of music. Like I could sing, but I never like sang. You know, like I could always carry a tune because, you know, I'm a musician. But I really learned how to sing when we did our first album, Mask, and I was forced to teach myself how to sing. And like, it's very hard for me to listen back to it because like, I don't like it. I want that music to disappear. You know, what's interesting is that I always put everything into the song, and whatever the song needed, I figured out how to do it with my voice. And I think that helped me really push boundaries and not think of what I can do with my voice and just figure it out, you know? I mean, that's pretty much how it happened.
Yeah, well, you listen through to the albums and it does have this real evolution of sound, and you can kind of see that you've given yourself space and room to grow, but it's must be really good to have this amazing feedback and this big response from the audience as well, as you're saying, getting a tour of Japan and getting a tour over to Europe. It must be really cool feeling to have the fans connect with your music as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the reason that, you know, we do it, because we get so inspired when somebody connects to the music or when somebody like, because I always put a lot of emphasis on putting the message into the song, something that's, you know, brings something light to somebody's life. So when we get those messages that the music really makes a difference in their life, like that's the biggest compliment to me. And then, you know, meeting people at shows, it's like creating this Edge of Paradise world. And that's what we always strive to do, is to create our own world that people can be a part of and bring it to all corners of, you know, the world. But, you know, when you're kind of in it, like we do this every day and we push the band forward every day. So it's for me at least, it's hard to kind of reflect on what's going on because we're always looking forward to the next thing. And everything is very hard, you know. It's a very difficult path to, you know, growing this, you know, worldwide thing, you know. So yeah, you know, we take it day by day and just try to do the best music we can and connect with a lot of people. So
yeah, well, as you said, it's hard to try and work out this scene and the way to connect to fans because they've got the streaming cycle as well that people get caught on too, and then you look over on YouTube, so you've got to kind of jump between the both. But I'm also a big fan of physicals, so I have to just throw that out there. Buying albums is also a great way to support the band and getting along to tours. Can I ask though, we were talking about your songwriting with the tracks there, can you tell me a little bit about your songwriting process for this latest album?
Yeah, you know, some songs start a little differently. Sometimes I start with some keyboards, I put some rhythmic samples together. Most of the melodies I write on the keyboard, and then I come up with melodies and words at the same time. Because for me, the music always inspired the words and vice versa. Then Dave kind of comes in and puts some guitars on it. Then we fight about it a little bit, and then we come back and it becomes better. So once we have a demo at home of what we have a home studio, so it's, you know, we have kind of have the complete song ready, and then we take it to our producers, we go into the studio and we lay down the vocal track, and then the track becomes solidified with the arrangement and everything. Then we go back and we do drums, and we start layering the actual song to the drums. So the drums, the guitars, and things evolve. Like, the song kind of stays what it is, but things kind of evolve when we do the actual tracking. So once we have the drums, we do the bass, guitars, I do all the keyboards at home, and then I go and sing, you know, do the final vocal track and a billion backing vocals and some programming. And then we send it off to the mixer, Jacob Hansen in Denmark, and then the song comes to life.
Yeah, well, when did you start working on this album? Because was this something that you were doing through 2020, or was it before? Or
yeah, you know, we were scheduled to tour. We're actually going to come to Australia. We had plans because we had the European tour. We're going to do US, Japan, Australia. All 2020 was touring because we just released Universe right before. But once everything got canceled, I was holding out hope to the last minute, but once there was no hope, we went into the studio with Mike Plotnikoff, who produced Universe as well. And Mike had Neil from 3 Days Grace, and he was like, you know, Neil would like to be, or, you know, I have Neil here zooming in from Canada. Would you be cool if he, you know, joins the session? So we're like, yes, of course. So that's how we started to work with Neil, and he had really great input because, like, our bands are so different, but it's so great to have his perspective. He really helped me evolve in a songwriter, seeing it from a different perspective and just kind of streamlining and everything in a really good way, you know. So nothing, there's no filler. I think, like, now the songs, every part really needs to be there. But then when we pretty much wrote all the songs and recorded all of them, and then Howard Benson took interest in the band, and him and Neil have a new label called Judge and Jury Records. And so we signed with them, and I went in with Howard, and I sang 5 of the singles. So he really pushed me even more as a singer because he helped me find this new edge in my voice that I didn't really have before, and that really elevated the song. And having him on our team really makes a big difference because it's like having all these people bring their own elements into the music just kind of lifts everything to a new level. So it took us a year, even a little longer, because we started writing this right before 2020, all throughout 2020, and it's just now coming out. So it's a long process.
A lot of work, but that would have helped having that home studio as well. You can work from, I dare say there would have been some restrictions and lockdowns and things like that, but having your own home studio where you can work from would have made the process a lot easier, I suppose.
Yeah, because I mean, that's where we write all the songs and, you know, do the arrangements. And, you know, when we go into Mike's studio, we were actually going there during the pandemic, and it was really interesting because it was so many unknowns and there was a lot of kind of fear and like nobody knew what's happening really. And like Mike, Dave and I were all in the studio. It's only three of us, so that was fine. But and then Neil was zooming in from Canada, and like in Canada they had crazy restrictions there as well. So we went through so, and we had such interesting kind of like, we talked about every conspiracy theory, we talked about every possible thing, and it was really interesting. And a lot of what we talked about inspired the songs, because I always come in with really crazy ideas and we kind of take it from there and evolve it even more. So it was really a cool process.
Yeah, yeah. Talking about themes, can you tell me a little bit about the track My Method, Your Madness, and what kind of what that track means for you?
Yeah, so that track kind of explores whether our choices have any rippling effects. Like what if, you know, it's kind of plays upon the string theory or multidimensional theories, you know, whether whatever you do in this life would it affect somewhere, or you know, just your actions, will it affect someone else or your life in the future? Because you can scale it up or you can scale it down. I usually scale everything up, and then when people listen to it, they can apply it to their life, you know? So yeah, it's kind of about that. Or, you know, do we matter at all? It's kind of exploring just kind of, you know, all about the choices that we make in life. Yeah, and then how it affects us.
Yeah, the siren's just there. Something's just affected someone, that's for sure. Can I chat about the latest single, Digital Paradise? Tell me a little bit about that track and what that means for you, and then we'll talk about the film clip as well.
Yeah, so Digital Paradise is all about our future, what will happen if we merge with technology. And, you know, the song started out to be about exploring what might be like living forever, or just exploring the idea of an afterlife. And then as the music evolved, like Dave put heavy guitars and I put more industrial electro rock elements, and then it took me in more of a digital direction. So we started to explore like how technology would play into it, like what would happen if we merge our consciousness, upload it into the computer, like would our soul be transferred as well, or is it just a digital copy? And it's always interesting to kind of post this out there and see how people respond, because people have such divisive views on all of this. Some people are like, yeah, you know, upload me, I'll be a robot. Or some people are like, no way, like, okay.
I think I've seen something on a Black Box episode or something about that, where they uploaded a digital consciousness into the computer or something. I don't know. I think I kind of like that, my digital consciousness being uploaded into a computer just to annoy people.
Yeah, and you know, recently someone said that to he brought up Matrix, and it's kind of the idea of that, because in the Matrix, you kind of live in this, virtual world, right? But would you want to kind of live in that and not know the truth? Or would you want to, like, I don't know, fight for the truth and live in a shitty world? So there's a lot of questions.
Yeah, it opens up that conundrum of the 100 different questions and points off of that as well. What was the film clip like to make?
So we worked on the film clip with a director. His name is Scott Hansen, and he's actually a filmmaker. So when I have some crazy ideas, he always kind of knows how to make it happen. And we first filmed with him the title track, The Unknown, and it was an on-location shoot in the desert. So he brought his whole crew, and we ended up in the middle of nowhere in the desert and filmed that. So we loved working with him. So we just said, hey, we have Digital Paradise, which is the first single, and he was like, yeah, for sure, let's do it. So we rented like this crazy location, and I love playing dress up, so like all the outfits, it's really fun for me. And then he had a great camera crew, and one of the cool things is like they put, you know, some of that kind of kaleidoscope effect, they put crystal on the camera lens, so it created that effect. So yeah, we just played around a lot, and see how we can make it look cool and kind of translate, convey that idea of what it, because the character in the video, you know, you see her like in chains to like this, all these wires, and then you see like the upload bar throughout the video, and it says 100% uploaded. But it's kind of up to you to decide whether like her soul got transferred as well, or is it just, you know, you know, kind of like just like a copy of her mind, you know? So yeah, it was really fun.
It came out really well, and it's got over what, 200,000 odd hits on it. Must be good to have that theatrical side with the film clips as well, to make those clips kind of engaging and people wanting to watch them to the end and getting all those hits on there as well. But those have got to transfer sometimes to it. Great to get all those listens and hits, but I've got to bring up about the physicals. Where's the best place people can get along and support Edge of Paradise, you know, buy albums? What do you have? You buy albums, have you got some vinyl set for this one, or what's your plans with physicals and everything?
Yeah, we're very big on physical stuff because I also paint, so I painted a piece for each of the songs, and we just did a digital Paradise bundle. The album wasn't out on pre-order yet, so it was just the painting with a t-shirt and this resin coaster with the artwork inside. Cool. But for the album bundles, they're going to be available in about 2 weeks, and you can find them at edgeofparadisestore.com or on edgeofparadiseband.com. So if you just Google us, you'll find our website, and you can go there and you'll find it on there. But yeah, it'll be albums, it'll be vinyls, it'll be an art book with all the paintings and lyrics. You'll be able to customize the bundle to the t-shirt or the artwork you want. So we want to make it really cool and special for people, because this is our fourth album, it's our 10-year anniversary, and we're really big on physical stuff, and everything's personalized and signed, of course.
Yeah, because it's really important to get along and support the bands and the scene. As you're saying, you kind of had that unknown factor when you were doing this album, probably a little bit of an ode to the name, the unknown as well. But, you know, it's like, where are we going to go from here as well? And we'd had all these tour plans cancelled, and I do bring this up a lot. That's why it's important for people. If you'd love Edge of Paradise, you're digging them on Spotify, head over and grab those links like Margarita said, and buy some physical copies. And it's really good that metalheads really want to buy physical copies. I'm a big physical person. I bought a heap of vinyls last year, 2020, because I couldn't go to shows, and, you know, merch as well. And I know people will get along and really support the heck out of you. So it's good to see those numbers and the support for you guys going forward.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah. And, you know, I think we're going to start touring in 2022. So we're going to keep promoting. So keep an eye on our videos and everything. We have lots of content coming out. And then we'll be announcing touring plans probably in September. And we're really, you know, fingers crossed that the world will kind of keep moving in the right direction. Seems like everything's opening up. I hope the winter is not going to set us back. So.
Yeah, well, that's it. 2022, I think, is going to be a good time for tours. I notice around now, I think a lot of local shows are being set up from bands in the area. Like, there's no international acts coming into any country, I think, at this stage still. So it's important for people to get along and support that local live scene going forward. And when you do announce tour dates for Edge of Paradise, everyone get along and buy tickets early. Don't wait to the last minute to buy them. Buy tickets early. Take a lot of swag cash and buy heap of merch as well.
Thank you. Yes, I agree with you.
Awesome. Margarita, I'm going to let you get about the rest of your lovely day. I'm going to go through my freezing morning. Any last words, shout outs, or thank yous you'd like to add in there?
Well, we just want to thank everybody for support. Thank you for watching this. Thank you for having me. And just keep an eye on our album. Make sure you pre-save it on Spotify. Visit us on social media. We love hearing from people. We're a very social band. So get to know us, and we hope to see you at the show.
Hey, legends, how the bloody hell are you going? If you like that interview and you want to see more, be sure to like and subscribe. Keeps me doing what I'm doing and make you a bloody legend. Ripper. Too right, mate.